So I'd like to ask a leading question. One, we talk about manipulation and sort of, Steve, to remind us when we got to Washington, I mean, we complained about Japan. Now we complain about the People's Republic. I wonder whether or not the debate is a bit off. Maybe we should be thinking about the fact that a group of countries in the world have inconvertible currencies. In other words, we're sort of stuck. I mean, we have a convertible currency, and lots of other people don't have a convertible currency. And for those of you who don't remember history, the French didn't have a convertible currency until late in the 80s. So, you know, so what else is new, right? So then what do you do about it? I mean, in other words, do we harmonize macro policy because we don't like the fact that they don't have a convertible currency? Do we institute a funny new currency for them? I thought we did that once before. I mean, what are the options? Because what's working now is rhetoric. It's Luftgeschäft. And so the Trump White House is basically doing lots of Luftgeschäft. You know, scaring a lot of people. It doesn't really...
Empty talk is what we call it.
Depending on how much German we had, right? But anyway, so that I want to start leading with that. And then open up to others.
Well, I don't have any profound thoughts on that particular question, but I would say I really agreed with what Jay said about the importance of macro policy coordination. And this is something, as you all said, we've been doing for years, different formulations, a lot done with Japan in the 1980s and 90s. And if we could, in the new administration, regularize that in some way, I think some of it should be done in the context of the IMF, which is the organization that's at least on currencies, has jurisdiction. G8, there are various forums for doing it. But I think it's important to do it saying we're talking about macro policy coordination. We're not talking about using trade punishments for something in your economy we don't like. Once you put these tariffs and things on the table, I think it makes it very difficult to have a frank and helpful discussion with other countries about macro policy coordination. I'm not even sure this administration has any macro policy. But once it's formulated, and it is something that they ought to be trying to figure out a way to get dialogue with other countries on, but it's got to be in that context, exactly what Jay said. Let's think about ways we can better coordinate our economies, not put it in the context of you're hurting us, you're eating our lunch, let's talk about your macro policies.
Yeah, so I mean, the first thing I would just say, Joel, on the inconvertible currencies, I think that is part of the point to me, which is in the sense that I don't need to intervene 2% of GDP in the currency market if I have really strict capital controls, right? And so, and it just in some sense highlights that kind of if you're going to build a set of rules, you're probably not going to catch the countries that are playing non-cooperatively sometime. But on the other hand, I really don't care if China has a relatively inconvertible currency if they at the same time were shifting policy towards more domestic demand, right? Like that's to me, the currency winds up being a symptom of the fundamental root issue, which is a lack of domestic demand relative to production, which if you're a small enough country, no one really cares. But if you're a big enough country, that has spillovers. And so, again, yeah, I agree with Steve. The macro coordination is where it would show up. I mean, there are venues, as you said, the G8 or the G20 over the last 8 years really has tried to play a central role here. It's just hard, right? I mean, countries have sovereignty. That's a pesky thing. We can't just tell each other what to do, or we can tell each other what to do. We just don't have to listen to each other, and that's where we wind up.
So we'll open this up for questions. Yes? This mic is coming your way.
Fantastic presentations. Wayne Morrison with the Congressional Research Service. I've been following this issue for a long time. And it's not just the Trump administration that's been pushing the currency manipulation. I mean, it's going on in Congress. I can remember in 2005, I think it was Senator Schumer pushing a increased tariff 27.5%. He based that on an average of studies that he read. And anyway, so I'm just very curious because this link between the trade deficit and currency, it doesn't seem to really make much sense in the way that if you push the country to appreciate its currency, wouldn't it raise prices? And because of the J-curve effect, you're actually pushing up the deficit. So it's almost like you have the opposite effect. And when we look at what happened when China did start to appreciate its currency, starting 2005 up to about 2014, about 35% appreciation, we didn't see really any change in the trade deficit. What changed the trade deficit was the global economic decline. I mean, the trade deficit decreased last year, right? That's because of China's economy, right? So what I have a hard time understanding is why Congress and now the administration is so fixated on exchange rates when, as you all pointed out, there are much broader and bigger issues. So I don't know if it's just a lack of being able to look inward and deal with our own problems of inadequate savings or what have you. So I guess the big question is, how can we get policymakers to better focus on the real important issues and, I guess, listen to economists on these issues?
Let's do one. Yes.
Hi, I'm Dave Frangel from Penn United Technologies. We're a manufacturer. I don't know how many manufacturers are in the room. We live at the other side of this conversation. And we really appreciate the comments that have been made. We're free traders. But when it comes to currency manipulation, for instance, it's just one of a bag of tools. It's like the pushing on the balloon example. You know, if you fix currency, there's a whole toolbox full of tools that a mercantilist nation can use to get back at, keep maintaining an unfair trade imbalance. It seems to me that this conversation needs to begin at the place where we first look at the, and we talk about it, coordinated macro policies, instead of, we don't call it mercantilism anymore, and I'm okay with that. What we ought to do is look at the way these coordinated macro policies affect companies like us that are too small to, even our whole industry could never afford a trade case. Never bring a trade case. If it isn't self-initiated, then, you know, it's not going to happen for us. Our whole industry can't afford it. For example, we are competing against Chinese imports that are sold here, precision machine parts, at less than the price of the raw materials. Not cheap labor. And they're buying the same raw materials that we buy on the same for the same price in the same international market. So something's going wrong there. And currency manipulation is only part of the reason they're able to do that. And what we're thinking is, first, we got to look at the impact of these coordinated macro policies on domestic producers trying to get a fair shake in the domestic market, in the U.S., and then talk about international trade. Would you agree?
Want to do one more?
Hi, Brett Fortnum with Inside U.S. Trade. I'm trying to really understand the problem with currency manipulation. Is it that it's a red herring for issues with a broader macroeconomic policy? Is it how Treasury defines it under the Bennett Amendment? Or is it the fact that even if we slap a currency manipulation label on someone, that there's really not all that much the administration can do afterwards? Why is this conversation kind of become rather circular in, you know, being able to point at China or Japan saying, you're a currency manipulator, and everyone going, well, so what?
Okay. Who wants to go first? Go ahead.
Sure. So just on the first question really quickly, I do understand why people focus on the currency to the extent that, you know, J-curve aside, it's a temporary effect. You know, on average, I do believe that, the elasticities work, that there is, in fact, an impact on trade flows from currency. And so in that sense, I understand why people are interested in it. I understand why, you know, a manufacturing firm may sit there and say, hey, a competitor in that country seems a lot cheaper to me, and the currency seems like, because the currency becomes this most visible way, you know, it's the way we translate the price from one country to the other, and so it shows up, and I do think it affects the trade flows. I mean, I think, frankly, you know, China's appreciation in the first decade of the 2000s, in some sense, it was starting from a fairly undervalued exchange rate and was appreciating at a slower rate than its tradables productivity growth. And so, you know, it never caught up in some sense. So I think that's why you didn't see it move the trade balance. The counterfactual, where they didn't appreciate at all, the their trade surplus is much bigger. I think on this question, when you're saying what's the problem there, I mean, I think the issue is that it's this very visible symptom, so it's why it gets so much attention, but it's not the root problem generally. And I think that's why I worry, at least, that when we put too much focus on it, I worry that it becomes the thing that we obsess over. And I really do think the Germany example is just a great example of where they're not manipulating their currency, right? Like, just by definition, they can't. On the other hand, but that doesn't mean their policies aren't problematic to global aggregate flows. And so by focusing only on the currency, we make a charge that is too easily refuted rather than focus our attentions where they'd be more useful.
Yeah, I
agree with that. I would just add that there's a tendency in this administration, it's really marked, is to blame others, other countries, for our problems. And as I said in my talk, most of our problems are homegrown. So if you start by saying, we're going to help machine tools or workers who've lost their jobs or all the sorts of things that really need to be done in our economy, by forcing other countries to change their policies, you really miss, I think, the whole point as to what needs to be done to make U.S. policies a lot better. Now, obviously, currency does affect trade flows. And there's no doubt that U.S. manufacturing, U.S. exporters were hit hard by an undervalued RMB. And so it does have that effect. And your industry could easily, or your company, no doubt that currencies can be a factor in what's happening to your company. The question is what to do about it. And I would start by saying, first, we should have better international rules to deal with it in the IMF and perhaps also the WTO. We should not think that some law passed by Congress can solve the problem. We can't deal with currency of all issues is one that you really can't deal with unilaterally. So we need more effective international law, and we need, if we're going to have a law, and the U.S. law that we have now is not so bad, but it makes people think that this is the source of the problem. And my point, and I think Jay's point too, is that the problem of job growth and slow economic growth and low productivity and all the problems we really do have in this country are not caused largely by trade or currency manipulation. They're caused by our own weak anti-competitive policies.
Do we have more questions? Yes.
Hi, I'm Danny Leipziger. So if we take the title of the talk and the two first sessions, we're not going to satisfy the new administration with either trade actions that follow some rules or the currency manipulation. So more likely, we're talking about something like the border tax. So I wanted to ask Jay, since you might have had to analyze this a month or two ago, there's some argument that the border adjustment tax, offsets the fact that we don't have a VAT and that other countries do. This sort of, I've heard this in meetings, that this is some justification for putting a tariff on, essentially. Could you tell me whether or not this, you know, carries water or not as an argument, and how you think a border tax would affect the balances that we're looking at?
Yeah. You want to wait for the mic?
Thank you. I appreciate the chance to ask another question. I question the focus on China, and I wonder how helpful it is to understanding the new administration. I don't speak for them, obviously, but I think we're rushing to judgment. We haven't heard anything reliable from the administration. We have one cabinet officer in this area who's going to be confirmed soon, right? The others are not yet there. There's a clear difference in the president's mind and a lot of the people's between campaign rhetoric and what they're actually going to do. My feedback from the meetings they're holding right now with industry is it's all about You said there's no policy here. It's all about investment in the United States, private investment and public investment. I think if there, I would predict, I don't speak for them, but I would predict that is going to be in a year what we say about them. But my question is really about Japan. And why would we come to, would we have a different discussion if this was about Japan as a negotiating issue? The TPP issue with Japan was that Mr. Abe got elected for, partly on the promise of a cheaper yen, and he delivered a 55% weakening of the yen. That basically devalued the 2.5% on average tariff concessions they were willing to give, imposed a tax on every possible U.S. export. So we created a brand new barrier, much higher than what we were removing. Isn't that a real issue? I mean, you can say over time it might erode and all that, but in terms of the calculus of reaching an agreement and implementing an agreement, doesn't that kind of policy sink the TPP?
One more. Susan Aronson, GW. Oh,
Susan, wait for the mic.
Susan Aronson, GWU. Could you talk a little bit about the indirect effects of calling out in newspaper interviews another country as a currency manipulator? For example, Navarro's interview on Germany. What that does in terms of trust among our allies and foreign investors. Thanks.
Okay. Who wants to go first this time?
Just real quick on the border adjustment tax. I don't pretend to be an expert on it. I went to a very nice thing at Peterson the other day and listened to people who have studied it more carefully than I have. I think on average, economists tend to think that VATs aren't trade distorting. And so the notion of putting in a border adjustment tax, I mean, it's very similar to a VAT. So if you did it the right way, and so if you want to say that you've decided to switch from a corporate income tax to a consumption tax, you know, that's fine. I don't think it's going to distort trade flows necessarily. I think there are a lot of other considerations you might worry about in terms of regressivity and things like that, that you'd have to look at really carefully. But I think it's much more of a technical issue of how you want to run your corporate tax system or raise revenues in general, and shouldn't be discussed strictly as a trade issue. I think, if anything, maybe the temptation is you can pretend other countries are paying it, but realistically, it's a consumption tax. Too much focus on China, there's certainly too much focus on China. On the other hand, China's a really big economy, and so it is an important part of global flows. On the Japan side, I guess what I would say is Japan has had, you know, persistent deflation. The notion that the proper policy response was to loosen monetary policy is, to me, very hard to argue with. even when the yen came a lot way back down from where you were mentioning when it peaked around 120, they avoided intervention, perhaps in part due to quiet behind-the-scenes diplomacy as opposed to one-offs in the paper, but they did. And so I think the emphasis that you've seen the G20 and the G7 talk about is domestic tools for domestic purposes. And if they're running loose monetary policy because they've got persistent deflation issues and the yen happens to weaken as part of that, then you let that go. If they explicitly talk up the goal of weakening the yen, then you get a lot more response on that. But I think this is where I said it's why, to me, putting the focus on currency manipulation is really tricky, just because it's a market-determined exchange rate. It's moving based on monetary policy choices, and it's almost impossible to say that either the dollar was undervalued when the yen-dollar was 80 or the yen was undervalued when it was 120, given how big a swing it was. And so I'm not a fan of the focus on that side. And just, Susan, on the question of the public comments, while technically I have a master's in law and diplomacy, I don't consider myself a diplomacy expert. And I would try to be open-minded towards the way different people want to accomplish their goals. It's not the way I would have. Yes. It's not the way I would try to pursue them. And I tend to think that we've been pursuing all of these issues and all of these goals in closed door meetings and at the G20 for the last 8 years. And that's probably a more effective way to go about it rather than firing one-offs. But I also, you know, I mean, we're 2 weeks in. They may stop. You know, that may have been a one-off that won't get repeated once there's a Treasury Secretary who reminds everyone that in the U.S. only the Treasury Secretary talks about the currency.
Good luck.
Okay, so there is a legitimate issue on the border tax. And the Congress, we've had in U.S. law since the Trade Act of 1974 a specific directive to the U.S. Trade Representative to try to negotiate a change in GATT and then WTO rules regarding the way in which our income tax is not border adjustable and the value-added tax is. Because those were that's what WTO rules say, and it was solidified even more so in the work around 1994. So we've had it as an objective set by the Congress to try to negotiate a change of the rules. No administration has taken that seriously. The Congress then, starting with the Domestic International Sales Corporation in 1971 and the Foreign Sales Corporation, passed all these laws to allow U.S. exporters to be exempt from income taxes. So it was kind of a self-help unilateral solution, which then got struck down by the GATT and the WTO. So that's the current state of play. Is it really an important issue for U.S. companies? Probably not. I mean, rhetorically, you can say that when European companies export, they can relieve from the cost of their exports the cost of government. And when Boeing or your company or anyone exports, the cost of government is part of the cost of the product. You can make that point rhetorically, whether it's really true from economic analysis, one people would debate. As to the Trump proposals on the border tax, in my view, clearly a violation of WTO rules, not even a close call. And so I would not support that. I do agree that we need more investment in the United States. That's the only way in which we can grow our economy. More public investment, more private investment. Not so easy to do. Lots of policies we can use to try to achieve that. The idea that we're going to get greater private investment by jawboning with companies to not move out or to move back in strikes me as not going to be particularly effective in aggregate. I don't think putting a tax, as Trump has said he wants to do, to try to force companies to invest here makes sense either. I think those are WTO illegal policy and would be a bad policy. But we ought to be thinking about how we increase public and private investment. On Susan's point about the tweets and the phone calls to foreign leaders, it's been really ugly and disappointing. My guess is that these calls have strengthened the Mexican president and the Australian prime minister at home. And that might be a good thing for those countries. So I think we have to look at that factor too.
We're done with questions because we're now chewing away the coffee time. Do you want to do one more run? Do you want to do it over coffee? Yeah, it's going to mess up your schedule. All right. Well, we thank you very much. It's a pleasure.